celebrate not only the Gullah Geechee Nation, but also the Lowcountry legacy history and also their contribution to American history. Tonight with us on our panel of esteemed, wonderful participants, tonight we have Brother Amir Jamal Toure, founder of Day Clean and also Georgia Southern, excuse me, professor of criminal justice. Also with us, we have Isaiah Quarterman, vice president of Georgia State University Residential Hall Association. And also with us is brother and also professor Ayinde Summers of Georgia State University. Tonight's resources can be located in the chat, but also they can be located at afpls.org/AARL. Tonight, we are reviewing and also celebrating the independent film released in 1991, written, produced, and directed by Julie Dash, excuse me, Daughters of the Dust. This generational tale of not only African-American, but Black women from the Sea Isles are struggling not only to hold their culture, but also to preserve it. Let's get started. Before we begin our questions, let's first review the film trailer to give a quick overview.
What they got out there anyway, Ola?
Life, child, the beginning of a new life.
Just because we cross over to the mainland, it doesn't mean we don't love you.
How you can leave this soil? This soil.
See,
the king here in chains.
When they go down in that water, they ain't never come up. Ain't nobody can. Chains. When they go down in that water, they ain't never come up. Can walk on water.
I need to know that I can come and hold on to where I come from.
A past on us. You think you can cross over to the mainland and run away from it?
Never forget who we is and how far we have come.
So, Daughters of the Dust has two narrators. Nana Peazant, and the other is an unborn child. The bulk of the narration of the film belongs to the unborn child, which transcends time and space, the youngest and the oldest of the Peazant family, which is a true representation of the multi-general tale and a reflection of also the connection of each narration and voice. Why, my question to our panelists, is it important that Julie Dash represents different voices of the family with the narrator? And my question again is, why is it important to each panelist that the director, Julie Dash, represents different voices of the family with the narrators of the film?
It's about evolution and continuation. One of the things that we understand, and it's not just Gullah Geechee people, for African people, we have to understand that we are continually evolving, that we are not stagnant, that we should never be stagnant. Now, I know that some of us, we think like that, and that, again, that no one can say anything. And so if we say it's intergenerational, it's important for us to understand that insight and wisdom come from all groups, that the young can provide wisdom and insight to generations prior to them, and that the generations prior to them can give the young wisdom and insight also, so that that way they know how to navigate the treacherous waters of the world that we live in this nation, in the society, and in life in general. And so we take, and so they can then take it to another level, because we go but so far, but then what will happen, they will take it to another level, and they then pass that on to others. So again, when we say voices for us, we always try to talk about, and I'm saying myself and Queen Quet, we discuss about balance always. The balance is one that we talk about with regards to male and female, but then also with regards to what we say, the young and the adults. And so often we like to get into these conversations about that we're not listening to the younger generation, and they say we're not listening to them, and we say they're not listening. That's false, because each generation has had this issue. I just had the conversation today with some folks here in Savannah. I said that each generation says this. So when we have our institutional memory to go and say, this ain't nothing new. So that's why in the family, we have the young and the elder all together. We're not interwoven that. Again, our conversations are one that we must embrace, all of us, so we have that institutional memory. You know, I can keep talking, but I'm a chill. I'm let the other go and say, but yeah.
I love the institutional memory.
Yeah, I totally agree. Listen, I just 2 weeks ago, I was on Saplo having the same exact conversation, Kamya Benya conversation. I'm already there. And so just this idea that the writer this she really captures it in this piece here. Just the nuances in the intergenerational play, the gender play, some of the other not so easy to deal with elements that she brings out inside of here. And they're always happening. And you have to learn how to contend with those things. And I watched it, and I watched it several times, every time is just something new. That I get. And so then for me, it's a piece that the author, the writer of this piece is sharing with us, right? This kind of paying it forward. And I've had the pleasure of going to Benin and participating in the Day of Vodou. And my actual first introduction to Gullah Geechee culture, as crazy as it seems, and today it's still crazy to me. I was 20 years old. I'm born and bred from Atlanta, Georgia, four generations deep in Atlanta proper. Never knew, never heard of the word Gullah Geechee. Never knew we had islands. But my first place I went to was the festival on Beaufort, South Carolina, at Penn Center, a festival that displayed the culture and its nuance and all of these elements. And in Benin, I found the same thing. And again, it's this same thing that I just want to keep calling them Day Clean, because every time I see him, I'll say Day Clean, you know? So, that same thing is right there, right? It's this idea that even on the continent of Africa, the Day of Vodou, the festival, we're trying to share this information intergenerationally, intergender. It's such a beautiful element of our culture as African people diasporically, that in this tradition inside of Daughters of the Dust, I believe is captured in its depth and nuance even. And I really appreciate the piece artistically and for its historic accuracy too. I love it.
Thank you for that. You know, moving us forward into homecomings and claiming our ancestral roots, Yellow Mary, to which she obtains her name based upon mostly a representation of colorism and also social hierarchy there. Yellow Mary returns to the island also with Viola. And after her many worldly experiences away from the island, What is significant of Yellow Mary's emotional journey in the film?
Well, as far as an emotional journey and how it relates to my own personal life, in all honesty, me and my peers in my hometown of Savannah, Georgia, is we always think like, let's leave Savannah, Georgia. Like, we're gonna leave, we're never gonna come back. That's what everyone thinks they're gonna do. But for some odd reason, everyone ends up coming back. Like, it might not be now, it might be 5 years later down the road, we're gonna come back. It just seems like that was so personal to me. Like, coming to Atlanta, and just learning the different cultures and stuff like that, and bringing it back to my hometown is a big thing for me. So I really connected with that part of the movie.
Thank you for sharing that. And how long have you been in Atlanta?
I have now been in Atlanta for, this is my fourth year in Atlanta.
Thank you. One of the things that I truly appreciated about the return of Yellow Mary is in the beginning of the film, when she speaks to Nana Peazant, they speak about not only their spirituality, but also their connection. And also that Yellow Mary is wearing a charm that she believes is going to protect her. And at the time, Mama Peazant, before she leans her head next to Yellow Mary to almost to connect in this sort of metaphorical way, you know, she asks her, you know, girl, do you believe that charm is going to protect you? And you know, she replies, you know, it's not much better than, you know, the roots, you know, that Mama Peazant also shared with the family. And also, you know, sharing is not only caring, but it also passed down, you know, protection. What many fear in certain regards, what I'm speaking about spirituality, many people fear it because it is it's a parallel, a contrast from Christianity. And that yet through the representation of certain glass bottle trees and coins and roots, and even certain imagery of having, if you notice throughout the film, their hands were indigo dyed. So it just showed not only certain class, but also how they utilize certain spirituality practices to unify them. And I appreciated that, just seeing that in their conversations with Yellow Mary and Nana Peazant. Before we continue, I wanted to show this quick film that really, snippet from the film, which represents remembrance and preserving culture history. As you know, when they returned in the film, Viola and Yellow Mary, they also were accompanied by a male photographer that would catalog not only their family, but also the journey to the mainland. Because not many of, not only saltwater, Africans, as they like to refer to, but just backwater Geechee did not want to make that trip. And so just representing not only certain male voices, but also the different contributions that it provided in the film.
I remember how important the children were to the Peazant family, and how I had to convince my daddy that I was his child.
to steal Bilal from Africa when he's just a Levi. He come over on the very last slave ship. Bilal come over on the Wanderer.
Before we continue, based on that clip, it was narrated by the unborn child, the child of Eulah and Eli. But most importantly, you know, the Gullah Geechee community is preserved not only by its geological location on the coastal, on the coast of the Carolinas, Georgia, and the tip of Florida, and also the Sea Isles, but also the culture and the language crafted in this area. You know, my question to each of the panelists is, why is it so important to preserve culture within the African American, and especially the Gullah Geechee culture? Is it truly a great contribution to American history?
I'm going to throw this out there and say this, that even when people talk about who we are, and I often tell people, you know, a lot of times I get people trying to tell me who I am. And I'm like, they don't know who the heck I am. And they have read some books, they've seen some videos, they've seen some people who gave out incorrect information. And years ago, because not only we, with regards to Day Clean, the African Soul, Day Clean Journeys, but we have Geechee Kumba, which we tell folks that is the epicenter of African culture here in the Americas, in the United States proper. And we make the connection at home and here in the diaspora, continental Africans and intercontinental Africans, that's what we embrace. And so when we talk about who we are, and just to throw something out there, and I've heard some people going to say some stuff about they freshwater Geechee, so freshwater this, they saltwater. We talk about that's a lie. We just say Gullah Geechee. Don't get into them other people in their battles about who we are. Stop that, because you know, y'all know Jamal going to be on here. Jamal ain't trying to play with y'all about that. You're not going to be coming at me with that and then pass on that misinformation to my people. Then make them not understand. Even some that they have done what is so shameful, the Gullah Geechee Corner goes from, and I just, again, today, just dealing some stuff today, goes from, some people try to say, Wilmington, North Carolina to Jacksonville, Florida. I'm like, lie. It's Jacksonville, North Carolina to St. Augustine, Florida. How are we going to leave out that important piece of who we are that connects us internationally with the God's story to Cuba and our ancestors, who some of them who made it to Cuba? How are we going to do that? I say, but you know why we do that? Because again, we don't continue to make the connection. So when you ask that question, Sister Ford, with regards to why is it important, it is essential. Because what will happen, the doggone elephants will think that they're mosquitoes because the mosquitoes are raising them. Here go elephants who are elephants and they're being raised by mosquitoes. And they're thinking they are mosquitoes. So it's not even natural. It's not even who you are. So what you wind up doing, not being your natural self and not ascending to the greatness, the regalness of who you are as a people. So that's why that becomes essentially important for us to do that, because what has happened for African people in general, we now let the mosquitoes teach us and we embrace what the mosquitoes are saying. We listen to the stories of the hunter where we are the lions. And we need to tell our part of that story with regards to that, because the lions have a story that we can go and clarify and say, the hunter came and tried to steal our territory. The hunter came and did this. So again, it's important for us so we can walk that walk of our greatness into the day of the sun, into the day in the light of the moon, that we walk into the stars, that we carry that with us and we embrace that. See, because too many of us have been led astray because we've been listening to them. When guess what? No one else will teach you your greatness. You must speak about your greatness. So each one of us here, we contribute to the greatness of our people. And guess what? We're not relying on somebody else to tell us that, because guess what? They'll never teach you to be great. You will teach your people to be great. That when you look in the mirror, each one from Isaiah to Ayinde to Forrest, that again, when we look in the mirror, Jamal, we look in the mirror, we see greatness in us. And guess what happened? When we then walk into these streets and we see one another, we smiling. We smiling because we see greatness in each one, everybody who look like us. But what is so detrimental that we have people who are educated, people who have wealth, people who got it going on, they don't love themselves. And guess what? They truly don't love you. And so the stuff they do is so poisonous that it causes us harm too. And my tell folks, guess what? I know that I'm a descendant of the best of the best. Only the best of the best survive. And because I know that, when I see each one of you, I know we got something in common that no one else in the world can even say, even embrace, that I know for a fact that somebody in your families survived just like somebody in my family. And that's a bond that's unbreakable. That's a bond that is God-given, God-designed, and that is the part of our divine purpose in our lives. And so that's why, again, knowing your culture, embracing your culture, and then passing it on. Because, again, you don't hoard it. You don't hoard it for yourself. You understand? You got to spread it. Because you know that some of us have been taught by the mosquitoes, and they don't understand that they're elephants. They have heard the words of the hunter, and they don't know how to embrace that. So, they embrace it. They don't understand to embrace the greatness of who they are. So that's why it becomes so important for us to do that. So that I get, like I said, because I deal with people that I think who should have understanding and know that they're the best of the best, and they don't, and they cause harm to us. So I say it becomes our job to be that vanguard of the vanguard to make something happen. So then that way that seed is planted in other people, that the jasper rock mushrooms into sacred trees.
Yeah, buddy. Listen here. Let me. I want to translate. He just said everything, but see, you know, folks in Atlanta, we might not understand quite everything he says. You know, I've been down in Sapelo this month, and I've been down there for about 7 days, intermittently. And so those of you all who don't know, Sapelo is an island in Georgia, off the coast, about 7 miles off from McIntosh County. Now, McIntosh County is the first county in the state of Georgia. And so there's an organization there, and we're sitting and talking to the people who were sitting on the porch late at night. Sitting in, I was having a realization. I've been coming down there and going down for 20 years of my life. I've never missed a year going down to Sapelo. And I sat there and I looked at some of the age peers that I have. And so what Jamal is talking about here is there's nuance to all of these things. When we talk about the sea islands, there are universities on these islands. On the islands that there's not a university on, it's a national park. On the islands that they're not a national park, it's a state park. Mm-hmm. And that's about it. And so then we have small communities that have been able to hold on. But when we're saying about what have they held on to, that's the piece that makes me smile. That's that piece that Jamal is talking about. When you hear people say things like, oh, when an elder dies, a library dies with them. As we sat on the porch on Sapelo, I was thinking about, I've gone and I've gotten my own oysters out of a river. But I didn't go get oysters. Because getting oysters is what you do for an industry. I don't know how to get oysters. I was taught how to keep oysters. Everything is a relationship in what we have identified and the tradition that is that we have been initiated into, and I would suggest is the Gullah Geechee culture. I know how to keep oysters, clams, mussels. I know how to keep them alive in that estuary. I know when we go fishing, and if I have a fish that I don't like, I don't just sit there and kill that fish and leave it on the dock. I throw that fish back into the ecosystem. Now, before we had the universities to come and tell us about these ecosystems and that we lived in an estuary and that there was environmental science, we were keeping it. We were keeping the cultures. We were keeping all of these things for not just ourselves, but we were keeping them for, just like Jamal said, we were keeping them not to hoard the culture, but to give because that's part of the culture. You understand that you are a part of a Beyonce song that she just put out recently. You are part of something way bigger. And I love the thing that Jamal said too, additionally, this idea of the we don't get into this salt water, fresh water, because it does disconnect us, right? And so when you get a chance to go to different places like Haiti, if you go to Cuba, I've been to Puerto Rico, I've been to Jamaica, you see our culture, it's the same culture. The same actions, it's the same practice. And that's how I define it. I'm not going to the Webster's Dictionary or Encyclopedia or getting the Dewey Decimal System to tell me or validate that I am Gullah Geechee or that this person on this part of the water is African or not. It's a practice that I have. That when I see them practice, when they go fishing, oh, you fish like we fish. Oh, you throw the cast net like we throw the cast net. Oh, we gotta be connected. And so then when we come to the library, and this is why I love Auburn Avenue Research Library, it has stored so much of our information and process that it does nothing but validates. It gives an opportunity for us to share this information with our children. The ones that don't get to see the crab yet, right? They get to see the crab in the book, and then we get to take them. So that right there, I really love what you were saying there, Jamal. And I just wanted to translate a little bit for people because there's so many pieces, especially when you grow up in it, that it just come out. And I'm like, yeah, everything. But I've also been in Gullah. I've been initiated in Gullah Geechee culture for 20 years. So I know what you're saying because y'all taught me well.
Thank you both. You know, moving us from preserving culture, also part of that is remembrance. Historical imagery and authenticity. You know, the film won an award for cinematography. A majority of the film is shot on location on an island off of South Carolina by author Jafar. Which is an esteemed cinematographer. Notable shots of Mary, Yellow Mary and Trula lounging on the willow tree in their white, and even women wearing white in different scenes with Spanish moss, as well as under the umbrella. You know, these are very notable to certain everyday life and certain hidden charms of the Gullah Geechee corner. What is notable about the way the film was shot?
So I just want to jump in real quick, Brother Isaiah, I'm gonna step back. That, I'm glad you brought that up. There's some incredible shots. There's a one that they have, and they call it an umbrella. But in tradition, in African tradition, from Fa, Afa, Ifa, those are similar. It all comes from the Ewe people, right? And so often people, they refer to it as the Yoruba tradition, they speak English. But there's what they call a parasol. And there's a shot that they have where the children have the parasol and they're turning the parasol. That's a tradition that comes a 5,000 year old at least tradition that comes from that Ewe region, right? And it was just so beautiful to watch that again for the first time and see that and like, oh wow, it was healing to see that that image and that they decided to put that in there. And capture that was one of those things that you're talking about. And I'll step back.
Thank you for sharing that, Brother Ian. I did not know that historical connection. I'll try to provide resources for that. That's such a great avenue. I didn't know about the film. But go ahead, Isaiah.
For sure. First, I'd like to speak my praise. Just being the presence of these two educated gentlemen just amazing, crazy. But a few ways these are shot is that it's very dreamlike. And one thing I have appreciation for this film is the way that it focuses in on the cultural aspects of the things. As you can see, it like zooms in on certain things. For example, like you can see the hands of Indigo, like certain shots, they zoom in on the hands as you can see them. The shots where he was angry hitting the trees, it zoomed out. And you see the full thing, the culture that shows inside each shot, it's just astounding to me. It really grasped my attention. Every single time I saw it, I zeroed in on a different detail. It was amazing. I loved it.
Yes, I enjoyed the way they captured not only certain voices, just with nonverbal languages, with the way they utilize certain angles, as you mentioned, but I also love the color contrast with the indigo. Also, Nana Peazant, which I'll show in this clip, she's one of the only characters that wears all indigo. Everyone else is usually wearing white clothing. They're draped. Also, their hair is done naturally in certain styles where it's braided or protective. Also illustrating certain imagery of unity. If anyone else has anything to share before I share this next clip, you're welcome to. I'm going to show some of the things that we mentioned, also some of our participants have also.
Hello, Mary. I'd like you to meet my photographer, Mr. Sneed. I've commissioned Mr. Sneed to photograph our family crossing over to the mainland. It's past, it's prologue.
I'm Richard Brody, and this clip is from Daughters of the Dust, a 1991 drama directed by Julie Dash. It's one of the most daringly constructed, visually astonishing American movies of its time. It tells a direct and painful story, or rather an interwoven skein of stories, with a technique that is as aesthetically stimulating as it is historically revelatory. It's set in 1902 on St. Helena Island, off the coast of South Carolina and Georgia, where the Gullah people live. The descendants of slaves were, as is said in the film, captured Africans who, living in relative isolation on the island, retained customs, religious practices, and even a language of their own. The story takes place early in the great migration of blacks from the south to the north and the west. It's centered on one family, the Peazant family, several members of whom have already gone to what's called the mainland and are returning to accompany many others who are preparing to make the trip north with them.
It lasted all and the fosser than new. The older I get, the closer I get to the ground.
The film has many overlapping fields of action. The family matriarch, Nana Peazant, who practices traditional religion and will not leave the island. The gentrified Viola, a devout and proselytizing Christian, who hopes to persuade her relatives to join her on the trip and in the church. The prodigal cousin, Yellow Mary, who has become a prostitute. The photographer, Mr. Sneed, whose curiosity about the residents of the island, where Muslims and Native Americans also live, makes him a sort of freelance ethnologist. And Eula Peazant, who married Eli Peazant. Eula is pregnant, she was raped by a white farmer, and the film is narrated by her unborn child, a sort of seer, who reports that she will have to persuade Eli that he, and not the rapist, is in fact her biological father.
I remember how important the children were to the Peazant family, and how I had to convince my daddy that I was his child.
Before we can continue, I enjoyed some of the images that we also spoke about. I also love also the horizon line and also its illustrations. Also, we have come across many bodies of water, but also there's a connection because it's highlight of the Ido Landing. This film highlights the family being very close to the Ido Landing and also the significance of that sacrifice. And also, well, many people arguably would say it is a sacrifice, but also it's a conscientious choice. In the film, when we see Eli and also Nana Peazant, when they explore the Ido Landing and also the wooden statue that represents the presence of the ancestors that decided to take their life as a reflection of taking control over not only their bodies, their mind, but also their life. And many people believe that this sacrifice or this conscious choice is not only a reflection of the journey of personhood for not only African-Americans that are in bondage, but also the will to represent their own narratives, to be captains of their own fleet, if not. But the panelists are also open to share any insight if you'd like.
Well, I want to throw something out there, and Brother Ayinde says something that was tremendous with regards to when he talked about the parasol. I was like, yeah, the parasol. Because again, we know it's also tied to the Jobeto omen. The Jobeto women, they are in Benin, who were the elephant hunters, those who were also protectors of the kings. And that again, that, and when they were no longer, when they in the moment of relaxation, they have parasols with them, signifying who they are, what their rank was, and then the power of who they are. So yes, absolutely. And there's someone I throw out there, not to say that they were not focusing on this person, but I go and say again, when we know our story and know our culture, that there's a man by the name of Richard Roberts. Richard Roberts is a photographer who was in out of Columbia, South Carolina, but he also did stuff down on Amelia Island, Nassau County, Florida, African-American. And so he is he's recording some of the history with regards to his photography. And so again, he's one of those prominent photographers that some people have forgotten about. And I go and throw that out there and say that that's why when I see the photographer on the island traveling with them, that is again, because I tell people, you know, photographers, videographers, you know, they're also historians. Because they are recording a moment in time. They're not helping us be attached. So that was Brother Isaiah and I being from the Port City, you know, those people who record those stories of us on the west side, on the east side, the south side, you know, when they record us in Tybee, in Chatham County, in Monte, that's the part of our story that, again, as we say early on about that legacy. So I look at that and saying that's essential. And then when you talk about Ibo's Landing, that again, some people get it twisted, that we understand that a part of that story is tied to Chatham County. And then folks didn't go on down. So they get tied to Glenn County, you know. So yes, but then they also go on to some of them on Sapelo, you know, in McIntosh County. So we understand that then, because they're divided in Chatham County off of Skidaway Island. And then so some are going taking up to Savannah River to be sold. So the story continues. And then we see songs like Oh Freedom, the story of the flying Africans, you know, the people who walk back, you know, to Africa, who go on the water. So all that is tied to, again, the continuation of our story and then embracing it fully. And that's why I say we cannot be ashamed of anything, because we reside in those who travel in coastal Georgia, coastal South Carolina, northern Florida. We are in the holy land of African America. This is the holy land of African America. So you can go to Jamestown, Virginia all you want, but guess what? You got to come to here first. And so that's when we know that at some point Africans in Georgia, South Carolina are free 1526, because they got with Native people, 1526. That's before 1619 and 1609, 1606 in Plymouth Rock. So this is the part of the story. So our story is the story of America. And in fact, I said we have one of the richest tapestries of the American story right here with us. And that's why it becomes so, again, crucial for us to be able to tell the story, to understand it, and then articulate it for others to understand and know that, listen here, we don't take the backseat to nobody. We sit at the table, at the head of the table. We sit at the head of the table because also, we are also now generating that same genius of our people. We're generating what we know as the Industrial Revolution based on our people contributing to that. So we don't shy away from it. And then we want to talk about Americana. We are Americana. So again, we talk from our Shaker Rays in South Carolina, Shaker Rays in the 1700s, that you think now you see a Shaker Ray right now, like that's something like that's brand new. We've been doing that. When you start talking about music, musical form, that's tied to us. So when we look at Ibo's Landing, so we look at that, the folklore being tied to what we share out there. And that's powerful for us. And that some of us shied away from it, and I throw it out there and say this right now. Georgia lagged behind South Carolina with regards to technology, because Georgia, people in Georgia wanted to have a Dr. King story. Everybody want a civil rights story tied to Dr. King, but ignoring the richest part of the story of African people.
You're right, right.
So we then ignore it. Then South Carolina, bam, runs with it. But then guess what? Georgia lagged behind. Georgia's playing catch up with regards to that. But then two other states, they lag behind even greater. Florida, Northern Florida, which is now playing, they coming up third, then North Carolina fourth. Here go, these states are essential to us, because I tell folks, Jacksonville, Florida is the largest Gullah Geechee city in the world. Jacksonville, Florida. Nassau County is in Port Chester. St. John's County, St. Augustine, the first underground railroad. Then we look at North Carolina. North Carolina, the first African holiday that we know that is prominently celebrated in this country that was still long lasting also was in North Carolina, in the northern part of the Gullah Geechee area. John Canoe. So here go people coming from outside the United States, from Central America. They understand. They hear John Canoe. They relate to people in the Caribbean. So that's why I'm like saying, yo, Ibo's Landing is one part of that larger story of us. And don't let us talk about Nyamin. You know, because Isaiah, you know, he's from Savannah. They like Nyam, you know, like to eat, you know, because, you know, don't let us talk about the food. Don't let us talk about the food, because the food, again, that's American history. That's American stories. That's American culture. That's Americana. But you don't want me to know who I am? And so that way you give it back to me like it's something brand new to me. I'm saying, no, once again, I sit at the head of the table and you didn't listen to me.
Wow.
Come on now. Listen, I'm gonna do it like this. I'm gonna say insurrection of 1899. This takes place in 1902. So that would mean that only a few years before. So those folks right there, I'm gonna leave some for folks to kind of think about. I'm gonna connect three of those places because absolutely what Jamal is saying, you know, there's this whole movement around borders and immigration. And I'm gonna say this, there is an event that took place in, South Carolina called the Stono Rebellion. Well, the Stono Rebellion, Georgia wasn't a state. Georgia didn't exist. So, but they came from Florida. So that means they went from Florida all the way up to South Carolina. There is a story, the ties that bind us throughout this region is so much stronger. There's a spiritual thing that binds us. And the other thing that I'm gonna mention is to what you were talking about about the horizon and these other elements is, and also connected to what Jamal was saying, is we were the university. The intellect and the capital, right? As we talk about capitalism, you have your land, labor, capital, but what they also fail to mention sometimes in that description is also it's the know-how, right? And so today we call it intellectual property. Well, when you walk throughout South Carolina on the coastline, you see all those metal workers. Well, in the movie, you have a scene where she's just showing the metalwork going on. I always tell people, I say, well, you think white folks had a university where they was teaching black folks how to do all of this stuff? So the basket weaving, so it was some white folks taught us how to basket weave, it was white folks taught us how to make the cast net and how to make the improvements on the cast net when we brought them over here. So as white folks taught, they taught us all of that. So they just became benevolent all of a sudden and just like, let me give to you after I have taken so much. And so then we ended up looking at all of these images inside of this movie. And she wasn't explicit. And then the last piece that I saw in here that just really, I mean, it warmed my heart, is there's a discussion that happens in the cemetery where there are gifts given from the young person to the elder. There isn't even this dialogue that happens around the elder person's relationship to those who have gone on, who are in the ancestral realm. And then the great-grandmother, great-great-grandmother tells her grandson, she says to him, the child that was given to you is coming from the ancestors. The womb and the ancestors are the same. And as a practitioner of African traditions, that this idea of the primordial womb, the being the keepers of that humanity, being the keepers of that and how we practice humanity with one another. When I look at the United States of America, when I look at the South, and I drill even further down and I look at the Gullah Geechee culture, we are practitioners of humanity. And when you look at all of the things, the great things that to this day that African people do in the Gullah Geechee community for as a gift, as from nonprofit organizations to, I mean, all of the giving that I know that Jamal does, from Geechee Kunda to the Gullah Geechee Corridor, I have yet to find such a giving people. I just haven't seen it. And even Dr. King himself, just to make this last connection, Dr. King himself, only months before his tragedy was taken from us, he spent his time in Beaufort, South Carolina at Penn Center. They had a house in the back by the water for him. And what he said before he passed on was that this is where the movement is, because he, like myself, this was a story, this is a part of who we are as people in Gullah Geechee that's been kept from us for various reasons. But him coming to that awareness and that knowledge, that knowing who he was, it was so healing for him. And they tell that story on Penn Central. And it was a wonderful and healing story that I learned as well.
Thank you for that. Wow, everyone is just dropping these just beautiful gems, like the wealth of knowledge. It's a blessing to be in the presence, you know, going on historical imagery and sharing, you know, that connection, not only spiritually, but it transcends each generation, but also the family tradition and ties that was represented in this film. Before we get into our question, let me just share a quick film insight from the film director, Julie Dash herself.
Daughters of the Dust is a movie about a family on the eve of their migration north. It's set in 1902 in the Sea Islands of the South, and those are those little barrier islands off the coast of South Carolina and Georgia. So it's the eve of the family's migration north, and the women of the family, who are the carriers of the family's traditions and beliefs, are arguing among themselves about who goes north and who stays home and why. And I think that is a pretty universal subject about growth and change within a family.
Mm. You know, Iona, the daughter of Hagar, longs to be with her secret lover, to whom is of indigenous descent, St. Julian last child. And Hagar is held back by another family member in the last scene of the film as she calls out to Iona, because she actually does connect and chooses to stay on the island with her partner. Why is it important, or what is the importance of Iona's name and her connection to her ancestry?
I was gonna let one of them go first, but I saw they were chilling, so.
Go ahead.
You know, one thing that threw out there that it lands on, I own her, because our names became important. I got to do something that Dr. Ben said. Dr. Ben said that man names himself so that that way he can be addressed accordingly. So I say woman names herself so that that way she can be addressed accordingly. And so that's what it's about. And we know that when our ancestors now have ended, they are now out of the period of captivity, that someone began to select names. That if someone, if they might say their name was Dembo Bird, that they want to say they're free as a bird. So that way they go and choose the name. So, and they began to choose names that if it's like Green, they won't associate that, they were breaking away. Even though it might still be an English name, they were still breaking away from the name titles tied to other people that was tied to oppression. So again, this is when we say names, is that we want to name our people, that your name should have some meaning. Your name should have some significance, because that's a part of who you are, how you need to walk in this journey of life. That becomes a part of what you want to follow in this journey of life. Or that's something that you aspire to in this journey of life. That if you say your name is Latif, then guess what? You aspire to be gracious, to be kind, to be subtle, to be insightful. That's the path that you're on. Not to say that you may do it everyday life, but you're working towards that. So you manifest that. If you say your name is Isa, then you know, and say your name is Jesus, that you're not sweating, that you are now saying, I'm gonna walk this path right here. If you're gonna say your name is Ayo, then you know you're walking that path. Or Ade, you know you're walking that path, saying that I am the crown. I am that, you know, that I am the head. If you're gonna say your name is Fatma, you understand that, you know, say I am a woman of courage, of nobility, that you understand that, you know, you understand. If you say your name is Anapoko, you understand that I make a sacrifice for my people, so then that they will live for generations. I make the personal sacrifice for my people. Mm-hmm. So that's why your name is important. So that's why it's just a carry over with regards to that, what you do in the movie. Also, you know, I understand that people know the name, that how, why her name is Iona. Now somebody might not like how it is, but then you understand that was the purpose of having a name. You just don't throw a name on a person. Even that person's name is, you know, Frenchie. And the grandma's name is Frenchie. You know, that's about continuation. That's about continuation. If that is, you know, Isaiah Quarterman II, you know that Isaiah Quarterman II is now representing Isaiah Quarterman I or senior. So then that way they walk that same path of that ancestor, of that noble father or that noble mother.
Hmm. Well, let me raise this question also. One of the characters, her name was Eula, E-U-L-A, which is of Hebrew origin. Is there some connection to the Gullah Geechee community and the 12 lost tribes of Israel?
See, again, you know, Jamal got no problem pissing people off. Now, I tell them, stop with that type of stuff. You know, we ain't got steal nobody birthright. You know, I'm like, Ayinde been to Benin. He not saw it. He see how magnificent we are. He see how great we are. So those people, when you do that, you ain't got to steal nobody else's birthright. Because again, now I'm taking to another level. We sit at the table of humanity, at the head of the table. Mm-hmm. You're the first ones on this doggone planet. So why I got to come over here and try to steal the birthright of indigenous people right here? Or then I got to create some mythology. We got our own significant mythology in general that's powerful, that's tied to this entire universe, to this cosmos. Why I got to do that type of stuff? And the people who do that in particular are Black folks in the United States. People outside Brazil, they don't be doing that type of stuff. And it's more of them down there than us, but then we create this mythology. And so I tell folks, I say, listen, you know, no matter, it's not our job to fight the Crusades. The Crusades were with the Bukras. Now, for those who don't know what Bukra means, Bukra means European or Caucasian. You go to Jamaica, Guyana, Belize, Barbados, they say, and even Suriname, they say Bakra. And it goes back to Africa where they say Mbakara. So again, Ife can beat up people. So again, it's European Caucasian. European Caucasian are the ones fighting the Crusades. That's not us fighting the Crusades. So we ain't got to fight that over here. That's why we embrace all of who we are. And so again, we ain't got to create the mythology about the 12 tribes, the lost tribe, and other stuff like that. Because again, look at Ife people. Look at the BDO people. Look at God. Look at Temne, Krebo, Shrebo. Look at all of them. Look at Valanta. Look at all of them embrace that science that they have with the God to understand it. And that stuff manifests in all of us right here in the Americas, African, the diaspora, the intercontinental Africans. We be embracing us and other stuff. Because again, I tell people, no matter how conscious they say they are, when you gotta deny the African journey of our ancestors, then the Mafa, then I tell you, you ain't got no real pride. You got surface pride. You got the pride to say that you're smarter than these other Black folks. See, because when you got that real pride, you then magnify the greatness of your ancestors, the ones who survived to make it right here. That one person, the best of the best. You magnify that. You start feeling that in your own self. But again, when you say you conscious, you woke and all this other stuff, but you got to go and talk about Crip, the lost tribe. You got to go and say that, you know, we are the indigenous people here. I'm like, yo, no, it ain't. Because you got a shame, but it's still tied to Africa. I go and look at Kemet. In fact, I throw this out there. Some people interviewed me last night. They asked a question. You know, that I said that these folks are insightful when they asked a question. They asked me about ayCleen. ayCleen is a Gullah word that stands for dawn, beginning of the day, the horizon. But it's also a philosophy of life. It means each day starts anew. So that why yesterday may have been the worst day in your life, but because you're here, ayCleen. You have the opportunity to not change things. You have the opportunity to go forward, ayCleen. But that word comes from a Wolof word, berset, which means the day is clean. Direct translation, it's a Gullah word, but it's a direct translation of a Wolof word. Again, Wolof, that's Africa. But then the people asked me a question. They said, what is the connection between ayCleen and Kemet, ancient Egypt? I just said, I said, y'all ain't playing right now. Because I say, I don't go and do it like this, but since y'all pushed me, I'm gonna go ahead and throw it out there. As we say, Berset and Wolof, guess what? And Kemet, they said something like Aket. And so guess what? There's something called Heru Aket, or some say Horam Aket. And what is it? It's Horus on the horizon, Heru on the horizon, and what most people call it, the Sphinx. So yeah, so the Sphinx that people see, and that Aket means horizon, and in Wolof, it said Berset. And Shea Antijob showed us clearly that there's a cultural unity in Africa, come from East Africa to Western Africa, and that's our people. So you wanna try to tell me not to deny that? I'm like, yo, are you crazy? Are you cracking? About the best, my nerves are not foolish right there, because I go, so that very word, ayCleen, even goes back to Kemet. Wow.
Wow. Hey, can we do this too? Let's do this too, since we're doing that. Let's do this too. So, you know, all the way to North Carolina, all the way down to Georgia, they have a thing that they taught us in school. They say it has four sides and they're shaped like triangles. What they call that? They call that a pyramid, right? If anybody on here want to suggest that, because I might be wrong. Because I know from North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia, they all have these things that they call the Indian mounds.
Yes.
Now, to my understanding, Indian mounds, again, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not the smartest man, I get it. Mounds are round, right? These round things is like half a circle type of thing, right? Like an ant mound, right? But when I went to the Etowah Indian Mounds, to the Okmulgee Mounds in Macon, Georgia, they all had, interestingly enough, they had these four distinct sides that all met at the top at a peak. So just interesting that you bring up this idea and concept of connection to Kemet when the Mississippian Indians, Mississippi East, all have these things that are shaped in a very interesting way, and the cultures continue to share these similarities. I just wanted to throw that out there.
Oh man, okay. Definitely check out our chat box, because we'll be providing resources to continue many of the research on some of the topics that we've discussed. But moving us forward, and also to continue that exploration of pillars in the Gullah Geechee community, Queen Quet or Queen Marquita Goodwin. This is just some insight about her from Dr. Jamal Toure. So let's join in.
Moment. Yedawi, Queen Quet, Marquita L. Goodwin of St. Helena Island, South Carolina, is the first Gullah Geechee person to address the United Nations. Since 1999, she's been invited to address other forums at the UN on behalf of Gullah Geechee people. Queen Quet was the spark behind the creation of the Gullah Geechee National Heritage Area.
And that was with, oh, go ahead.
Like, I was gonna say, you ain't told me you was gonna do that. See, you
look him.
I'm just gonna say, I see what you did. You did what we're gonna say, play fool to catch smack. Play fool to catch smack. I got you. Ain't say nothing. Isaiah, she ain't say nothing to me. Wait till I talk to your mom. Wait till I tell your mom. Nah.
Oh, you can't go tattletale now, man.
Hey.
Oh, man. And let me say, and one thing about the movie and the fact that, I mean, even what you've done here for us, I think it's important to note for in particular for African men in the South, we get a bad rap. Septima Clark, for anybody who might not know who Septima Poinsettia Clark is, from South Carolina, and a teacher, and also the leader and the builder of the freedom movement. When I say super educator, I would encourage people to actually go and read some of the stuff that she's done. I mean, an actual super educator. She's a Gullah Geechee woman, and the movements that she was able to start, and if she was not there, she's the catalyst for so many movements that please go look up, because I have a whole nother point. Marquetta Goodwine, Queen Quet, is an epic figure in the last 20 years, holding up the Gullah Geechee banner, literally, and taking it all the way to the Fed, right? Taking them to the bank, making sure that people understand who we are as Gullah Geechee people, reawakening, igniting. And she has built so many things. While Black men have been following her lead, as we do traditionally in our culture, when, as Jamal says, when we know who we are, we know of that primordial womb. We know from where life comes from and how to honor. And it comes out, and again, I give the example of Septima Clark and the one that you brought forward for us. These leadership from Black women has been extraordinary from the Gullah Geechee community.
Thank you for sharing that. The significance of just even mentioning Queen Quet is that this film not only is multi-generational, but it's a tale of Black women, a collection of them, not only as they make the journey to the mainland, but also when they return to also in a Sankofa effect to reach back. And as we see the different reflections of that acceptance of change and also contributing to that, we see a contrast between not only Yellow Mary, who actually stays on the island, and those that leave, like Hagar. So my question to our panelists, what issues or behaviors or mind states or circumstances in the story can you note as being a carryover from slavery? Which of the characters' mind do you think is most enslaved or least?
Well, some behaviors that I noticed while I was watching the movie, most definitely behaviors around the birth of the child, the unborn child. That was a big thing. Them just not telling the husband, or Eli, I believe his name was, mm-hmm. about mm-hmm. the baby in general was a big thing I could think of. Just because of the fact that they want him to get hung because, you know, once you find something that happens, you don't want to, you know, just sit down and be like, you know, everything okay. You want to go do something after that. So they were protecting him. And another thing, definitely the Indigo Hands, I know you mentioned that, but Indigo Hands, Hagar was definitely the most enslaved mindset in general, just because she felt like Christianity was the most important thing in the world. Everything grandma was doing was wild. And it was crazy to me because I don't know about y'all, but you don't really yell at grandma like that. Like, that never happens. And so when she was yelling, I was like, oh no, you need to go to heaven, you need to go to heaven. But she's actually the most like closed-minded person in the entire thing because she was rejecting her own people's culture. Lise had to be Nana because Nana was the most open-minded to everybody. Nana was the person welcoming everybody in. Even when Yellow Mary came in, she was open arms to her as well. Like, because you know, someone didn't want her there. She was definitely like, oh, this hussy, this, no, this and that. But then like came here, like knelt down, put a hand to her face, like, you know, talking to her, you know, as grandmas do. So that's how.
Excuse me. True. I enjoyed that sort of respectability politics there and respecting their elders, especially when we saw how Yellow Mary, as you mentioned, when she connected and conversed with Nana Peazant, how she knelt down, almost not as a reflection of being inferior, but also just as a way of showing that connection, that relation in family, and also that she's returning, and that not that she's her equal, but in a sense through their womanhood and through their contribution and dynamic in the family, that there's a certain thing that you pass through each generation. And also, did any other panelists, if you had anything to share to the question, or do you need me to read?
Yeah, it looked like I agree with you, and it was profound to see this. It looked like an initiation, and that she was completing this process, even the journey across the water to get to the island. You know, it was, she's veiled, right? The images that she got into some deep stuff as a director. I mean, she was, it was powerful. And she played that thing out, and you know, she goes before her elder, and she does, they make that connection, right? They put their heads together. And you know, and all of the intimacy. She spends time with the tree. She goes out, you know, she's looking over the horizon before she goes, and she sees her elder. And she tells her some things that, you know, she lets her know. It's like almost like she got a spiritual consultation or a reading right before the oracle. And you see the mother playing with the bat. She's doing the basket, but then she has this box of things that she's going through. There's a group of people in the four corners of the nation that we live in, and they make baskets almost identical to the sweetgrass baskets that we make in the Gullah Geechee. And they talk about reading these baskets, right? And I've also heard that, you know, in West Africa, about being able to read as people are doing. So I just saw all of these different connections, but that element of she's going through something. She even goes to the river. You know, we're following Yellow Mary. You know, it was an incredible and beautiful transition that the Yellow Mary makes, and the decision that she finally makes. And she had a partner that was willing to go through with her. And that was a whole nother element that was like, wow. And look at this, is because this is who we are, right? Yeah, it was beautiful. That was a beautiful element. The women characters in there were so sophisticated. Mm-hmm. It would take another woman to help me break that down. That was beautiful.
Thank you for that. Well, you know, most importantly, if you guys look at the flag, because that is a flag behind Queen Quet, it reads, "We be Gullah Geechee anointed people." And also a part of that is the angel tree, a reflection not only of the connection, but the roots that are still tied to the land that we were also brought from. But more importantly in this film, there's a spiritual legacy, because not only does it explore not only root work, but also certain ties, certain African practices. And before we get into our next question, there are certain things in the film that we saw as far as newspapers on the walls, blue box, models, the heavy use of the color, not only indigo, but of blue, as not only haint blue is used, that is painted on the front of certain porches, but also throughout certain homes to ward off certain haint. And haint is a spirit of evil or something that is a bad, but also certain other imageries. So we'll review this next clip before we get into our question.
When we was children, we really believe you could work the good out of evil. We believe in a newsprint on the wall, your tree of glass jars and bottles, the rice you carry in your pockets. We believe in the frizzle-haired chicken, the coins, the roots, and the flowers. We believe they will protect us. And wherever leading, we honor love. I ain't been scared of nothing. And no one. Because I knew. I knew my great-grandmother have it all in her pocket. Walk it up. Never forget who we is and how far we done come. I believe here. I don't have no other choice. Eli, there's a thought, a recollection, something somebody remembers. We carry these memories inside of we. Do you believe that those hundreds and hundreds of Africans brought here on this other side will forget everything they once knew? We don't know where the recollection comes from. Sometimes we dream them, but we carry these memories inside of we. What are we supposed to remember, Nana? Are we one time was able to protect those we love? On Africa, where we were kings and queens and built great big cities? I'm trying to learn you how to touch your own spirit. I'm fighting for my life, and I'm fighting for yours. Look in my face. I'm trying to give you something to take north with you, along with all your great big dreams. Call on those old Africans, Eli. They come to you when you least expect them.
You know, excuse me, while Hagar wants to extend herself and not only her perspective, but integrated into society, as she actually is sort of limited based on her own thinking and prejudice. While this belittles, and she does belittle Nana throughout the film because of her backward thinkings and her clinging to her spiritual practices, it somehow maintains Hagar as being politically backwards herself. How is she backwards in her stint? And by her, I'm referring to Hagar. Throughout the film, as you all remember, she was very critical of not only those that wanted to stay on the island, but also their acceptance and continuous practice, even in the transition of moving to the mainland. It was almost as if she wanted them to, in their great exodus to the mainland, to leave all, leave even the backwards of, and what we saw in the clip of what Nana mentioned was what the Africans had distilled in us through our remembrance. As remembrance is almost as if a power that we have as the people of color.
Yeah, it's, believe the word that comes to mind is assimilation. And We use the word, but I would suggest that it's an initiation of it in and of itself, and that what there was a persuasive conversation going on, right? There were those who are you willing to abandon all that you know, all your tradition, all of the culture that brought us to where we are now, to be rid of that and come to the new world, right? And be new, or you know you. Or stay here. And even that scene in there where, you know, the Nana explains what's going on, and And in a rant, she demonizes the roots. And so I think that that's a piece in there too, to just kind of, for me, solidify that, you know, she's in her mind, she has accepted, in order to assimilate to this, I must demonize that.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, and also to add on to what Brother Yunye said, I have put it out there. Well, that's how some of us are today. That's what some of us are about today. When we talk about these issues of gentrification that's happened in our communities, and that some of us want to act like gentrification is just in a neighborhood in Atlanta, or a neighborhood in West Oakland, or just in Brooklyn. I'm like, all the land loss that occurs in our communities, whether it be in an urban area, in a suburban area, in a rural area, in a coastal town, or an island community, it is all gentrification that has always gone on, and they go and take it from our people. And then because some of us don't have a concern about maintaining, holding on to uncle's property, grandmama's property, you know, daddy's property, we don't have no concern, because it's just about where we are right now. Yeah. So that's what that represents, so that they can go look at, people need to look at it and say, that's not something in time, and that is just that person. They need to put the mirror on themselves and say, am I like that too? So again, the gentrification, all that happens, and so that's what that person represents, the person who now is turning it back. Because see, I'm in New York right now, and I'm not planning on going back down there. I'm not planning on going back to Monticello. I'm not planning on going back to Atlanta. I'm not planning on going back to Dorchester. I'm not planning on going back there. I'm not planning on going back to Cowpens. I'm not planning to go to Attapulgas. So again, you're now up there in Detroit. You're in New York. You're in Philly. You're in Los Angeles. You have no concern. But these other people want your people property. Mm-hmm. They didn't get that property. Then you would be having a thought about what y'all used to have. It's no longer about what y'all used to have. Mm-hmm. It's about the maintaining, because when you have the land, you are a custodian for the land, for the next generation, because that provides autonomy. And so psychologically, you are a custodian to pass on the information to the next generation. So, because again, it's about autonomy when they know who they are. And that they then value at. They value the jewels that have been given to them, that have been provided by these people who made it over here.
Right. And again, it's about keeping, right? How do you take care of? Mm-hmm. And what Jamal said earlier, this is not about hoarding culture, right? We share it. So, you know, I've had the pleasure of during COVID-19 talking to Emory Campbell and a couple of other leaders in the elder states people in leadership in the Gullah Geechee community. And, you know, it hurts my heart to tears when I hear these elders say this thing here. Two different occasions. During COVID-19, they have talked about the word. When they left the Gullah Geechee, you don't say that you're from the Gullah Geechee. When you go to Chicago and you Gullah Geechee, you don't say that. Because during their day, it was shameful to say that.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
But I listened to them, and I've heard them say this before. But now that we are all much older, I could hear the pain when I was listening to them say it this time. And it just struck me. I was like, man, so the conversation that we're having, you still bring that up like that, that you're holding. And so I think it's very important for us to make sure that we're holding on to each other very closely, very tight, and that spiritual connection, making sure that we're doing more care for each other. For our spiritual and emotional beings, and because that's what is talked about in the film. Mm-hmm. that connection, right? When they're sitting in the cemetery, she says to her grandson, "There, as after forget what his name is, after your granddaddy died, there has not been a day that I don't come and see him." And I was like, wow, that's something else. That's something else. And so many of us have run away from these ancestral grounds. So the gentrification, the depth of it, what does it mean that we are so eager to run away from where our people, where they lay? What does that mean about us? What is that connection to this idea that these elders who are 80 and 90 remember and hold on to that trauma of being literally demonized as for root work? For, oh, you do them roots. Y'all from Creole. You Creole. Oh, you Geechee. Oh, you must be a root worker. Oh, you drove down there. You must have went to go work the root on somebody. What does that mean that we still carry that? What bigger for me is, if they're holding on to that, what are they not letting go of? What are they not sharing because they're holding on to that trauma?
Ooh, that's the word. Oh, wow. Okay. Leading us, wow, that's a great note to lead us into our last question of the night. Cultural references in pop culture. This next clip is just, we'll just view it very briefly before we get into it, but recently, Gullah Geechee culture, it has become a popular cultural reference as its representation of great Black resistance and strength and unity. Before we get into the question, let's review this quick clip.
Why do you deny yourself heaven? Why do you consider yourself undeserving? Why are you afraid of love? You think it's not possible for someone like you. But you are the love of my life. The love of my life. The love of my life.
Nine times out of ten, I know you're trying, so I'm trying to be fair. And you're trying to be there, and you care. And you're caught up in your permanent emotions. All the loving I've been giving goes unnoticed, it's just floating in the air. Looky there, are you aware? You're my lifeline, and you're trying to kill me. If it wasn't me, but you still feel me, like on my worst day. Thursday enough. I don't care about the light.
All right. So Julie Dash's film Daughters of the Dust has provided an obvious touchstone for Beyonce's 2016 Lemonade music video that we just saw. The singer's visual album literally not only tackles issues in Black womanhood, but also Southern traditions and history, and also highlights what we just saw, the Ido Landing massacre, mass suicide of 1803. Why do you believe, my question to each panelist, the Gullah Geechee culture is becoming a popular culture reference for representation of Black resistance, unity, and strength?
So like so many images inside of the movie, it is I'll explain it as a man who I actually go spend time with in Benin. His name is Dr. Eric Badosu, and he wrote a book. And in the book, he explains the word Sankofa. And Sankofa, we understand it to be like, go back and fetch your story, your history. And but there is no word in English for what we know, again, Ifa or Afa or Fa. the geomancy practiced to do divination or give readings. And so fire is central to culture around the globe. Everybody has a tradition of practicing geomancy, actually, all in, including Europeans. And so in that, there's, so then when you recontextualize that and understand that fa is to go back to the 256 universal spirits that speak to us through the fa, that's what the fa is. And so it's, so we go back and fetch it. So right now in this moment, whether we want to or not is irrelevant. But what's happening is this spiritual reawakening is we're going back and fetch it, right? All the way from Daughters of the Dust. This is a moment that we are going back. We're turning back to our ancestors. We're turning back. We're considering, maybe there's something different I should think about when I think about Gullah or Geechee. You know, the amount of tourism that comes to the Gullah Geechee has increased tenfold. The unfortunately, the commodification of our culture in Gullah Geechee region has also increased. But I think that that's because, forgive them for they know not what they do. They're so steeped inside of the traditions in of capitalism, the practice of capitalism we have mastered. That, you know, even when we come back and fetch it, we still have some of these other things we need to cleanse off of ourselves. So I think that's what's happening. And that's what it looks like to me.
Thank you, Brother Ayinde. I appreciate that. Did you have, well, you know, I also appreciate that, but not only did I appreciate the unity, but also the color imagery, you know, seeing not only that white linen and the women in their natural hairstyles and that representation of not only just not only each individual strand, but a collective, that the Black experience is not only a collective narrative, but each essential voice is welcome and beautiful. And so, you know, when many people explore the Ido Landing, a mass suicide, they consider it to be like a dark corner of history when we examine the Gullah Geechee Quarter. But I hope that I charge many people to view it as a beautiful contribution to the voices that we see and are heard throughout the film. Did any of our other panelists have any other insight they'd like to share before we in tonight's discussion?
I want to share this, and Brother Ayinde brought it up. One of the things that we talk about also, and we've been on some Zooms and some presentations with Queen Quet, we've discussed about commodification. That's happening a lot. Commodification and appropriation, but commodification, that again, people are coming in and they are making money off of us, and they've always done that with regards to our story and our culture. And so I don't have a problem with African people are using the elements, because again, it's some embracing aspects of it to then, as I said, to expand and help in the evolution. But we must be sensitive about commodification and misappropriation with regards to who we are and our stories. We must feel that what our stories are, that they are sacred and must be respected, mm-hmm. and that we will not tolerate it. Because some of us, you know, we shied away from being a part of the foray of Gullah Geechee being known, but others did not. And that's why I'm saying some of our families, they maintained that because they understood how sacred it was. Our culture and who we are was sacred, just like the land and just like the waterways. And so that's why we have to make sure we protect, maintain, nurture what we have that's ours.
Thank you for that. Such beautiful history. You know, I've enjoyed not only the insight, but the history that was provided, and also personal stories from each panelist. You know, Isaiah Quarterman, also a brother, Jamal Toure, and brother Ayinde Summers. Each of their information, as well as resources for tonight's discussion, and in celebration of Gullah Geechee Heritage Month, this month-long observation were provided through Auburn's official social media and website. I've truly enjoyed each of you. I hope you all are taking care of yourself, prioritizing your mental health, but also cherishing this time during COVID. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Enjoy your evening, and I'll speak with you all soon.